love and God of power, grant us in this burning hour grace to ask these gifts of thee, daring hearts and spirits free. God of love and God of power, thou hast called us for this hour. Good morning. And welcome to worship at Trinity United Methodist Church in Anderson, South Carolina. It has been 3 months since we have been able to gather together in person for worship. And while we are grateful to have had this opportunity to come together through modern technology, we are all waiting for that moment when we can gather back together in our worship spaces once again. Next Sunday, June 21st, will be that time. We will have our traditional services at 8:30 and 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary. Our contemporary service will be held at 10 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Of course, there will be no Sunday school or other gatherings. There will not be a nursery available for small children. These are important things to keep in mind. Our worship service will last only about 30 minutes. Things will be very different and will look very different as we gather back together again. Your staff and lay leadership have been working together hard to come up with a plan that allows us both to gather and also to keep everyone safe, or at least as safe as possible. Where we are now is sort of the word of the day. Observing the best practices with the information that we have on hand at this moment. In a couple of hours, if you were signed up and are on our eCare list, you will be receiving an email inviting you to sign up for one of those three worship services next Sunday. This will allow us to know who plans on being here so that we can plan and prepare the best possible seating arrangement for everybody to socially distance, and also to keep you from getting up, getting dressed, coming to church on Sunday morning and discovering that all of the services are already at capacity. There will also be a link to sign up on our website, or you can call the church office to sign up. Later in the week, if you have signed up, you'll get a letter explaining to you what to do from the moment you arrive on our campus until it's time for you to leave and go back home. And you'll need to plan to do this each week, at least for the foreseeable future. If you are sick, if you've been in contact with anybody who has COVID-19, or if you're in a high-risk category, we invite you to continue to worship in the safety of your home. Everyone over the age of 3 will be asked to wear a mask while inside the building. We ask that you would please bring your own with you, and we will have a limited number of masks available when you get here. Again, in keeping with the best information that we have at this time, there will be no singing. While we know that not everybody is connected to email and internet services, we ask that you share all of this information with people in your circle of influence, your Sunday school classes, your other groups, whom you may think might not be hearing this word. All of these practices are shaped to where we are now. In a few weeks, the landscape may look totally different, and we may be able to adjust some of our guidelines. Folks, we're learning together. None of us has ever done this before. And so I thank you. I thank you for your patience. I thank you for your understanding as we begin to live into our what's next. God of love, God of power, make us worthy of this hour, offering lives if it's thy will, keeping free our spirits still. God of love and God of power, thou hast called us for this hour. When we gather in God's presence, it's important for us to say what we believe. And so this morning, I would invite you to wherever you are, to say with me the grounding and shaping and forming words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And as God's people, rooted and grounded in this faith that sustains us and leads us and shapes us and guides us, when we come together, we pray. And so I ask you now to gather your hearts and your minds together as we come before the Lord. God, we are grateful for the privilege of coming together as your people. It doesn't matter how we do it, but that we do it is important. It's important to you, and it's important for us. We thank you for the many opportunities that you continue to give us to love, to learn, and to live as those people that you have called us to be. Today, we name in our hearts before you those who are ill or infirm of body, of mind, or of spirit. We ask that your healing touch might rest upon each one and meet each one at their point of deepest need. Gracious God, we continue to pray for your guiding and your leading as we move through these uncharted days. Continue to go before us as you have gone before your people throughout the history of your salvation. Help us to trust you. Lean not to our own understanding. Guard us and guide us. Shape us and hold us. And now, as your Son Jesus taught us, we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. I'm one of those people who grew up in church. That may be the case for some of you. It may not be the case for many of you this morning. In fact, there may be some of you who are watching this who, during this time of pandemic, have been looking at worship services and churches online and trying to get a feel for what this life of faith is all about. I grew up in church. And pretty much every time the doors were open, I was there. I was that kid. But even with all this time in church, when I was very young, if you'd stopped and asked me what it meant to be a Christian, what it meant to follow Jesus, I'm pretty sure I would have had a hard time coming up with a good answer. If you'd really pushed that question, just based on my observations from growing up, I would say something like, well, it means that you pray before you eat. It means that you don't play cards or go to the movies on Sundays. It means that you don't sleep in when there's church. I guess it means you can't smoke, you can't see certain movies, you can't drink certain beverages, and you certainly can't use certain words. I think with my limited experience, that's something like what I would have said. That's all that I was able at the time to piece together about being a disciple. The best I could tell, it meant do this and don't do that. Always go here, never go there. Wear this, not that. Believe this, don't believe that. That was just my impression of what it meant to be a Christian. Nobody ever said that to me explicitly. It's just what I had picked up on the way. Being a Christian, I thought, was about learning and following the rules. There are a lot of rules. You might have had this experience growing up as well. You may be having that experience now, I don't know. I mentioned this morning because of our gospel lesson. And in our gospel lesson, somebody approaches Jesus, and this person is an expert on the rules. You've probably heard of the Pharisees, experts in the law. And so this Pharisee comes to Jesus, and we read Matthew 22, 34 through 40 from the Message translation. When the Pharisees heard how he had bested the Sadducees, Jesus that is, they gathered their forces for an assault. One of their religion scholars spoke for them, posing a question they hoped would show him up. Teacher, which command in God's law is most important? And Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your passion and prayer and intelligence. This is the most important, the first on any list. But there's a second alongside it. Love others as well as you love yourself. These two commands are pegs. Everything in God's law and in God's prophets hangs from them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. These two commands are pegs. Everything in God's law and the prophets hangs from them. There were two kinds of authority back in Jesus' day. First, there were the Sadducees. And the Sadducees were the priests. They are the people who stayed around the temple. They're in charge of worship. They make all the decisions about what goes on in and around the temple. The other religious leaders are the Pharisees. If the Sadducees are the priests, the Pharisees would be like the religion professors. They were experts in the law, and they knew it backwards and forwards. The Sadducees and the Pharisees didn't like each other very much, but they had one thing in common. What they had in common was that they both really disliked Jesus. He was out there teaching and preaching and gathering these big crowds together. So they set out to trap Jesus, back him into a corner, put him in between a rock and a hard place. So by the time our text picks up, the Sadducees have already made their attempt to trap Jesus, and Jesus escapes. The Pharisees see that the Sadducees have failed, and so they think, aha, now it's our turn. We'll get it. So when this Pharisee comes up to Jesus and asks this question, he knows exactly what he's doing. He already knows the answer to what he's about to ask. What rule? What rule in the law is the greatest? He knows that all of the good rabbis in his day would have said, you can't elevate one commandment over the other. They're all equal. They were all given by God. To elevate one or the other over against all the rest would undermine the authority and integrity of the commandments. He knew that there was not just one that Jesus could pick. So he walks up to Jesus and he says, let me ask you a question. Which commandment, which rule of all of the rules is the one that's the most important? And here's what Jesus does. In quoting from the sixth chapter of Deuteronomy, he says, the most important commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your mind, and with all your soul, and the second always travels with it. And that's the commandment to love your neighbor as yourself. Oh, this was such a brilliant answer. It comes from the passage known as the Shema. It would be sort of like knowing the Apostles' Creed that we said together just a few minutes ago. For the Jews in Jesus' day, the Shema was like an affirmation of faith. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then it launches into these commands. The Pharisees can't possibly say that this isn't important. There's already a precedent for elevating this a little bit above the rest of the laws. And Jesus knows exactly what he's doing here. And then he says, all of the other laws, all of the other commandments are based on these two. The translation we read from the Message uses that image of pegs. Everything from the law and from the prophets hangs from them. There are 613 commandments in the Old Testament. Jesus is saying that every one of those hangs on one of these two pegs. They're the core of everything else. Love God, love others. It's that cross-shaped life that we talk about over and over and over again. Jesus takes this occasion of the Pharisees and the Sadducees trying to trap him and makes it into an opportunity to teach us what is foundational to our faith. We are to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. These are the pegs on which everything else hangs. The common denominator, of course, is love. This is important. This is important because Jesus is teaching us that our faith isn't about rules. I thought rules was what was important when I was growing up, but Jesus is saying, no, not exactly. It's about love. And love is about relationship. Love God, love others. That's the bottom line. In our mission statement here at Trinity, the first statement that we make is that we are a community of faith that is committed to loving God and all people. This isn't just something that some committee once upon a time thought up. It goes all the way back to Jesus' words that we have read this morning. Here at Trinity, we have stated that being a disciple begins with loving God and loving others. It means that our lives as individuals and as a community together centers on this. It doesn't matter which worship service we attend or what Sunday school or small group we may be part of, whether or not we're here every time the doors are open. These are the pegs on which everything else hangs. Everything that we do here should be hanging from those two pegs. They should be helping us grow in our relationship to God or in our relationship to neighbor. Learning God's will and ways, our next statement, and living for Christ in the world are impossible until this first one is in place. Loving God with all of our heart and our soul and our mind means bringing our whole selves into these relationships, the good, the bad, the ugly of us, all of it, and trusting God to take who we are and what we have and use it in God's service. I heard somebody once say that the best way to love God is to love the people that God loves. That may not be the best way, but it certainly is a good way. David Brooks highlights the challenges to this kind of living. He says, it seems that the smarter we get about technology, the dumber we get about relationships. We live in a society in which loneliness, depression, and suicide are on the rise. We seem to be treating each other worse. The guiding moral principle here is not complicated. Try to treat people as if they possessed precious hearts and infinite souls. Everything else will follow. Are you loving God with all of your heart? Your passion, with all of your soul, your prayer, with all of your mind, your intelligence? Are you loving your neighbor, including those with whom you disagree? Are you loving them the same way you love yourself? I hope you'll spend time thinking about these things this week. I know I'm going to. As we leave this space this day, for a while, I remind you that wherever wherever you are, wherever you go, you're not alone. That God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit goes with you and remains with you now and forever.